God really dropped a word in my heart here, and I think we can build something around this. What does it mean to live by faith? What does it mean when you hear people say, I live by faith? Now, I'm going to say something that's real important here. There's two things in all of our lives that God has granted us. Two things. One is, He granted us time, and He granted us faith. How many of you hear that? Amen. Two areas of your life that God gave to you, and He gave to you because the Bible says He gave a measure of faith to every man. So God gave you faith when you were born, and God gave you time. Time. Now, the thing that we have to do, we can't get time back. We can manage time, we can learn to manage it, but you never get time back. You can redeem time, and that means you get value out of the time you have left. Are you listening? Time and faith are two essential components to any person, and especially to a believer's life. Now, what does it mean to live by faith? And I'm going to talk about this a few more times because I really want to build some faith under your feet and under your foundation. Everything begins with faith in God. Can you hear that? Everything begins with faith in God. Salvation begins by faith. You have to believe that God is, and that He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. If you're going to come to Him. So your salvation is based on faith. Look at me a minute. You had faith before you met God. Because when you came to an altar as an enemy of God, you knelt down and got up and you believed God. But you had enough faith to know that if you came to that altar, God was going to be there and God was going to change your life. You may not have understood the full ramification and the broadness and the depth and the whole picture, but you had faith to get up and say, come in, God. So you had faith before you met God. Wow. The Holy Spirit gives us power in our lives by faith. Healing begins by faith. Ministry begins by faith. If you put Hebrews chapter 11 on the board, verse 6, and go with me a minute, I'm going to give you some verses to look at. This is the great faith chapter. And if you look at verse 6, it's faith that connects us to the source of all our supply of life. If I have faith, I believe God will. And when I have faith, we all have faith, I know God will. Now my faith can grow. My faith can be enlarged. My faith can really, really expand. I have faith today. I surely didn't have it when I first got saved. But I have seen the goodness of God so many times and in so many ways, I know my God is able to do above and beyond what I could ask or think. Anybody here witness to that? Now, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. The title of my message today is Faith That Pleases God. But without faith, it is impossible to believe God. Now, we just said you all have faith. Now, here's what that Hebrew word there and that language there in the Greek when it's talking says, but without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's really written this way. If I don't apply faith to whatever I'm standing in, I can't please God. Have you hear that? Because it's not saying without faith, I don't have faith because you have faith because God gave you faith. But the real rendering of that is, every day in my life, I get an opportunity to apply the faith that God's given me, and it grows. Yeah. Are you there?
Yeah.
And it says, but without faith it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder, please underline that word, of them that diligently seek him. God has the greatest reward program in the world. How many of you like to get rewards? You get gas, you buy the little gas card that gives you a reward system. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Or you get an item and it gives you a little reward card, and every time you fly, I have a credit card I use for my flying, and when I fly, I get rewards back. I get reward system back because of my flying. And then when I charge every dollar I use, I get a mile free. So I end up with a lot of mileage for free, and I end up with money at the end of the year, and it helps add tickets, and it helps me get upgrades to first class and things like that, because it's called a reward system. Have you understand what I'm talking about? Come on, are you awake today?
Yes.
Now, in this process, it says, without faith, I can't please God, because I got to believe that when I come to him, that he is a rewarder. He has a reward system when I approach him with faith. How many of you want to approach God today with faith?
Yes.
When you approach God with faith, he is a rewarder of your faith. He's not rewarding you because he likes you. Don't be offended. He's not rewarding you because you cried all night. He's not rewarding you because you're poor. He's not rewarding you because you're pitiful. God rewards faith. Now, the reason you're not in the rewards club is because you're doing things every day with no application of faith. You're not living in faith, walking by faith, talking by faith, so there's no reward for what you just said. How many of you want to change your life and get into his rewards program? All right, let's go a little further. Your faith is the most important thing that you possess. Time and faith. Your faith is the most important thing that you possess. Now, tears, as I just said, tears don't always move God, but faith always does. Our specifics, sacrifices, don't always move him, but faith does. A broken heart doesn't always move him, you know, repentant heart, but faith does. Needs don't always move him, but faith does. How do you know when God looks at you, he didn't bless you today because you were needy? Because God's not a welfare system. And too many of us have grown up under entitlement programs, so we approach God with the same attitude that I'm getting a handout from the big God. God rewards according to your faith. And your faith pleases him, he rewards you. You could cry all night long, woe is me, I'm undone. In a world of people of undoneness. And God says, too bad. But then something in you says, God, your word says, and I believe you will. And all of a sudden, the ear of God turns and moves towards the edge of heaven and says, hold up, hold up. I heard something. How many of you know a lot of people pray every day? And they pray out of their needs. If you see somebody that's a lifelong committed calamity Jane, Christian, or Jim, Christian. It's somebody that's constantly living in a recycled calamity. is because they never apply faith to what they believe. Yet you can find somebody that all of a sudden has the most radical conversion, the most radical twist of faith in life, and they just all of a sudden, it's like God just started smiling on them and blessing them. Hello? That's called his favor. David had a whole bunch of brothers. Samuel goes to appoint one, takes them one by one. No. After them all, he says, the prophet says, well, don't you have one other son? The little kid on the side of the hill with the sheep. Yeah, that's the one. Bring him. Why? Because David had caught the attention of God. Because David was killing bears and lions, and his faith was so powerful that it was yelling out to God. How many of you know a man can come to the altar right here, and a man can come to the altar right there, pray the same pitiful prayer, and get up, and one man will go away empty and seemingly rejected, and one man will get up and their life will begin to transform. Hello. I got up as a drug addict. And I was there in a large group of people at the altar. And my life got changed. Because when I came to that altar, I believed the God who was talking was going to change my life. Because I didn't have any choice. Go to jail or be killed were my two options. So my measure of faith went into gear and God began to change my life. How many of you say, Lord, I need to change my approach and apply faith to what I'm doing? Come on, have you heard me today? Now, your faith is the most important thing you have. Faith always moves the hand of God. It causes him to intervene in the affairs of men and to work on their behalf. So we all need more faith. Come on. All things are possible, it said, to him that believe. Hello? All things are possible to him that believe. Look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3. I'm going to back you up and just read a couple statements. And here it is, through faith we understand. Look what it says, by faith we understand of the whole of creation, the world's made and all that. By faith, how many of you today say, I don't understand? Well, by faith, you can understand what's ununderstandable. You see, when somebody dies, and I don't know why they die, by faith, I step into another arena, and I have an answer because I have a hope of the answer that's in me. I have understanding when I see people I love not serving God. My understanding by faith gives me the ability to handle it till God intervenes. Wow. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4. By faith, Abel offered unto God. How many of you know it was a better sacrifice? By faith, Abel offered unto God. Hebrews 11, 5. By faith, Enoch was translated. How would you like to be translated? I mean, you know, instead of going through the funeral business and instead of getting in a box, wouldn't you just like to just say, excuse me, and step from there into there? Well, by faith, Enoch and God were walking along. And God said to Enoch, son, You're too far from your house. Come on over to my house. Relationship is what that faith operated in. Hebrews 11, 7. By faith, Noah prepared an ark. What a crazy thing. He built a boat in the desert. Nobody does that. It had never rained. Do y'all know that? It had never rained before. And it didn't rain then. The water came out of the earth. By faith, you know, some of you need to build something for God in your life by faith. Even when you're standing in the desert of your life, you need to build something for the glory of God. You need to get into that place of that desert relationship and say, God, I'm in a tough season and I'm going to build an ark for my children, for my family. By faith, Noah built an ark. By faith. Verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed. It says when he was called, those of you that came to the called meeting Friday night, your tests are being put in a machine. They will be evaluated, and you can get the results within a week or two. We'll let you know when they're available. Now, by faith, Abraham, those of you that are called, He did something different. He obeyed. People who have faith obey their faith. When God says, I need you to do such and such, they don't obey just words. They obey their faith that if they do that, dip yourself seven times and when you come up, you will be healed. Where is the faith of the church to believe the prophet and to believe the set man of a house today in God's economy? When some of you, I've almost got to threaten you to stand up. You are so rebellious, you can't even stand when a preacher asks you to stand. Hello? How then do you expect God to move on your behalf if you can't obey faith? Still here today? Now, I could preach on this for about a year because this is my life. I live by faith. I live by faith. Look at verse 9. Come on. They were prompted by faith. He dwelt as a temporary resident of the land. Look at verse 11. Look at verse 11. Because of faith, Sarah herself received physical power to conceive a child. And some of you that want children, you need to have faith to believe that God will cause a seed. I have a preacher friend. He wanted a baby so bad, he tried and tried and tried and tried and tried and couldn't nothing happen. So he did like Sarah did, went and got an adopted child. I'm not against adoption at all. I love adoption. But he couldn't wait, so he adopted a child. Then he adopted a second child while his wife was praying and others were interceding. And then something happened. And then they couldn't find the spigot. So after the fourth child, he began to change his prayer and said, Lord, I repent of my doubt. Remove that unbelief from me. After the fifth child, he said, oh God, what are you doing to me? After the sixth child, he said, oh God, have mercy on me. Faith is an amazing thing. Come on. Faith is an amazing thing. Oh, God. Some of you today are going to miss the best message I've preached in a year, this year. Anyway, verse 20. Look at this, verse 20. With eyes of faith, Isaac, looking far into the future, evoked blessing upon Jacob and Esau. With eyes of faith. How many of you know you've got to have your eyes anointed to see by faith? I see what's not here before it is here. Some of you need to say, Lord, anoint my eyes to see by faith. Verse 21's fine. Prompted by faith. You got to see. You got to be prompted. Go on, turn it to 22. Activated. How many of you got to see? You got to be prompted. You got to be activated. 23. Come on. Prompted by faith, Moses after his birth. You know, I could read the rest of this. Look at verse 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. They're taking too long. I want you to get this. Look at that chapter over and over and over. By faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, God did. By faith, God did something. Look at me today. The reason God is not doing nothing for you today is because you're not applying faith. You're applying your mental intellect and hope. Now, this was all done that was done by faith. What can faith do? All things. 1 Peter 1:7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of the Lord Jesus. Now, listen to what he said. The trial of your faith. See, some of you quit because you have a little trial. I really, really wish I could get this generation to man up. They call you snowflakes. Not because you're color, but because you're frail. Because you're going to fall apart. We have crying rooms at our universities. We have Play-Doh and things that you can play with to console you. A young man in the church here the other day came and he had a splint thing on his hand because he had 9 stitches. And he was kind of moping around and kind of wanted me to see, you know, woe is me. I looked at it and I said, no big deal. I'll give you a good story, I said. Oh, okay. You thought I was going to tell him a story that was going to let him, you know, sit down and take a break. I said, the Oakland Raiders, years ago, in one of the big Super Bowl games, playoff games, one of the defensive players, his name is Woodson, Rod, he did something pretty amazing. He broke his finger, his little finger, at a 90-degree angle. It was like that. Supposed to be straight up, and it was sticking out like that. Well, they're going to take him out of the game because he can't close his hand. He went in the back room, cut it off, taped it up, and said, Coach, I'm ready to go. They put him back in the game, and they were successful. Some of you go, oh, my God, he cut his finger off. Grow up. The Bible says, if you're, what does it say? If your hand offends you, how many of you know your hand's offending you a lot? We ought to have a bunch of one hand with one eye missing. We ought to look like a bunch of pirates with a hook and a patch. You say, what kind of Christianity is this? It's Bible Christianity. It's what Jesus preached. Your faith has to be tested. Jesus told the disciples that he would give them keys to the kingdom. Keys do two things. Unlock and lock. Unlock and lock. Bind and loose. Bind and loose. Matthew 16, 19. Go there. It was plural keys. I'm here today to give you keys so that you can open doors of faith in your life. How many of you want to please the Lord today in something you do? Anybody here like to please the Lord? Then listen to what I'm saying. Your activation of your faith is what pleases him. Your whining does not please him. And God goes, next. Hello? But when you activate faith, heaven comes alive. Angels start to move. Heaven begins to celebrate that you spoke something you believe. When you pray and believe, you have whatsoever you say. Wow. Look what it says. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind, declare to be improper and unlawful on earth must be what is already bound in heaven. And whatever you loose, declare lawful on earth must be what is already loosed in heaven. How do you get that? Say, Lord, thank you for my keys. I have keys today. I will give you keys of the kingdom. Now, so much of the world, I'm going to come with back to that because that's going to help us put it all together. So much of our world issue problems today is based on money. How do you know the kids in Chicago, the drug dealers are killing each other for money? I was a drug dealer. Big time. No slouch. Big, big time drug dealer. I was moving drugs by the volumes of the volumes of volumes. I understand that world. And it's all based on money. The Colombians were moving vast amounts of cocaine into America for money. The Mexican cartel is not doing it because they like to. And here's the real key. Most of those drug dealers don't use drugs. They ain't doing it for the drug. They're doing it because you're going to give them enough money to get that new airplane because the one they got's dirty. Hello? How do you know the drug world is set in motion because of money? Those without it are living, lying, stealing, and killing to get it and what it can buy. And then those with it, it is the very thing that's trying to destroy them. Come on. 1 Timothy 6. Look at this. In the NIV. If you don't have it, I'll read it. NIV. 1 Timothy 6, verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. How do you hear this? For we brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it. You say, well, wait, we were talking about money a minute ago. Hold on. I'm going to help you get it. Well, we brought nothing into this world. We can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation of a trap and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Have you hear that? Love of money is the key word. Loving money becomes a root of evil. Now, some people eager for money have wandered from the faith. Wait a minute. Aren't we talking about faith today? Well, it says here that some, because of the love of money, some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and have pierced themselves with many griefs. Do you know how many people that I have worked with over the many, 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 many years that started off in God? Brother Mel will tell you, we start them, we help them, we minister to them, pray over them, they get a business going, it begins to flourish, and then they turn their back on God. Now you got to hear this. God will show up and require of them, this day, thou fool, thy soul is required. You hear me? I prophesy with my mouth, eyes open. There'll be a day that God will come and say, thou fool, thy soul is required. I've lived long enough to watch people that God has blessed, and they took it for themselves and left God. Many of them are dead. Many of them are broke. Because God will not let you offer something to Him and then take it back. I have a friend. He's an elder. He wanted a child, got a little boy. He grew up 8-9 years old. He idled. He was a lawyer worth millions of dollars, this man was. He idled this child. He worshiped this little boy. He was going to raise him up to be all this famous. And one day, the little boy contracted a disease, a sickness, a sulfur reaction of something. And his pores began to open up and blood began to pour out of them. And the doctor said, we can't stop the bleeding. He's going to die. And the dad was at the bedside for a week. And his little bed had linen kind of cloths wrapped around him. And you could see the red through it. He was just bleeding out. As they put it in, he was bleeding out. Put it in, he was bleeding out. And they finally said, he won't make it through tonight. The dad laid there and put his hand on the little boy's arm and said, God, I'm sorry. I made this child bigger than you, more important than you. And Lord, I'm sorry. I give you permission today to take this child. I'll never again put something in front of you. And the man laid down his head on the bed and on the boy's arm, and he fell asleep. This is a friend now. I had business with this man. Hours passed, sometime early in the morning. This man awoke to only see his son sitting up. And the little boy had taken some of the linen and pulled them off. And the blood was not coming through. God healed that kid completely that night. And he never had that issue again. You see, God, when he hears your prayer and you say, God, I give you my life. I give you my time. But I take it back because I can do better with it than you could. Be careful. Because there'll be a day God will come and say, thank you. That child, that job, that company belongs to me. I will receive it today. Are you still in the room today? There are those that want to get rich quick. Proverbs 13:11 in the Amplified says, wealth not earned, but won in haste, or unjustly, or from the production of things for vain or detrimental use, such riches will dwindle away. But he who gathers little by little will increase his riches. That's pretty clear. God says when you begin to manipulate, you begin to con things, and you begin to just get the money and get the deal, you're going to end up, and it's going to be a detestable thing. And it'll dwindle away. How do you want to have wealth that lasts? I'm older than a lot of you in this room. And God has given me wealth, and my wealth is lasting. And now my wealth is set up for my children and my children's children. Yes. Now, until your wealth can become multiplied down, you haven't got wealth. Yes. Because as long as you got money that you call wealth and you're spending it, that money is not an investment to the next generation. And Malachi says, I'll bless you. I'll open the windows of heaven, pull you out a blessing you cannot contain. That means I'll give it to your children, your children's children, to a third generation. How do you want your children to get blessed? How do you want your children that aren't even born to get blessed? Wow. Anybody still here today? The Word of God gives us, I'm landing, the correct view of money. That with faith applied, it leads to success. But remember, there are always pits to fall into if we're not wise. And I just shared with you a couple. Deuteronomy 8, 17, 18 tells us in the MSG. That's not that stuff you put in Chinese food. MSG is the Message Bible. And you know, the man who wrote the Message Bible lives in Maryland. If you start thinking to yourselves, I did all this, and all of it by myself. I am rich, and it's all mine. Well, think again. Remember that God, your God, gave you the strength to produce all of this wealth so as to confirm the covenant that he promised to your ancestors as it is today. How many of you can say with me, Lord, what you've put in my hand, you did, not me. Come on, how many of you say, Lord, you put it in my hand. I didn't do it. You did it. Wow. Remember, success in finances, in life, in health, comes from being healed and having a healthy soul. 3 John 2, you know the scripture. 3 John 2 tells us, I would that you be in health and prosper, even as your soul doth prosper. Soul is the mind, the will, and the emotions. How many say, Lord, I'm going to prosper because I'm going to get a healthy soul. A healthy soul applies faith instead of doubt. A healthy soul lives by faith and not by your own energy. And then when you get a healthy mind, will, and emotions, a transformed soul pleases God. When your mind is renewed and transformed, you please God. And everything God has ever made, it produces and grows. Do you know scientists say that our bodies, the entire cellular system, renews itself every 7 years? That's pretty cool. Every 7 years, seven, the number of complete, God restores you every 7 years. Yeah. How many say, Lord, I thank you. We're in the calendar year of 5777, 777s. It's the year for us to be renewed, made complete, made whole, to prosper, and to live by faith. Yeah. 2 Corinthians 4:16 says, our inward man is renewed every day, yet our outward man is dying. Romans 12:2 says, our mind, our soul must be renewed so we can do God's will and please him by faith. We can't be conformed That means fashioned. Like or cut from the pattern of the world. When your heart is there, is your treasure. Say, Lord, I need my heart to line up with my faith. Say it again. I need my heart to line up with my faith. And then I need my mind to come in agreement with my heart and my faith. Come on. Wow. The key that unlocks the treasure is faith, and faith is what pleases God. Can you say amen today?
Amen.
Would you stand on your feet today? I'm going to pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray all over this room. I pray for the power of God to be released. Would you let faith arise? Put your hands up. Get up on your feet. Act like you're trying to reach into heaven. Stop scratching, stretching. This is not an exercise class. This is a time to put faith up here and begin to believe and say, God, your word is a word alive in me. It's a word of faith. Now faith. Now faith. Now faith. Now faith. Now faith is the substance. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By faith, I can move mountains. By faith, I am healed. By faith, I can run through a troop and leap over a mountain. By faith, I can see miracles happen. By faith, I can walk on water. By faith, I'm going to get a raise this year. By faith, I'm going to have a miracle happen for me. By faith, I'm going to see my loved one come into the kingdom. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Pray it, pray it, pray it. By faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, my family's going to get saved.